dangerous position. But my point is that my
dear. But I'm saying one crazy action shouldn't justify another crazy action.
No, I'm just telling you that my point is that the government's terror script is that the RSS should be in the focus so that opposition unity should be broken. The left-right unity against the anti-establishment. Okay. Basically, the government wants to save itself from this moribund state. Government is at the moribund state.
Fine, we've heard you.
I think you've got your political science wrong. I don't want to attack you personally, but you are saying ridiculous things. I just want to say finally two, three things. One is that the government, we don't know whether the government and the security establishments would really go all out and investigate this case professionally based on facts and not come under political
Fine.
Pressure of all kinds.
All right.
That's what we hope for. And two, yes, we have to wake up to Hindutva terror in our country today. Three, correctives should be done for all the injustices carried out. And four, we should, I think, the BJP, the RSS, their politics of hate, similarly the Islamists, their politics of hate.
Absolutely.
I think the future of our country today, which should be separate from that of Pakistan, which kept on denying homegrown terror, I think the real thing which will demarcate us from a country like that, which will make a healthy future for us, which will bring a healthy future for us, is that we really nip terrorism in the bud of all kinds.
People often ask me, how often do guys just walk out of the big fight? Actually, it's not quite as common as you might think. In 2011, it only happened once, and that too during a debate on the poverty line.
There are still 400 million poor people in this country, at least. And about 180 to 200 million of them go to sleep hungry every single night. That is perhaps the single statistic that all of us as Indians should be the most concerned about. Now, once again, some attention has been focused on that by this entire debate over whether 32 rupees defines you for being below or above the poverty line, which we will take a look at, but also the overall question of what we can do to actually eradicate poverty.
We are getting mixed up at a particular point. When you say 32 rupees, this is a face-saving device of the government. It's a scale which they put. Once they put 32 rupees, it is about 40 crore people. The moment they put it 35, it is about 45 crore people. The moment they put it 38, 40, 42, the fact remains in last 10 years, in this tenure, more than 15 crore people have gone below the poverty line.
You're saying 150 million people have gone into poverty in the last 10 years.
And the moment you move the scale up from 32, 35, 38, 40, you will find the number of people coming below the poverty line is growing. Now, this is what we need to assess in this country is not this figure of 32, 33. First, in reality, go and assess how many people are actually poor.
Sanjay Nirupam, the question of 32 and also the assertion that Rajiv Pratap Rudi has made, which I'm sure you will take issue with, is it true that 150 million people have become poor since you have taken over?
At the outset, I will never support this poverty line determination thing like 32 rupees. Whoever is able to spend less than 32 rupees will be covered under BPL. I don't approve all these things. This is awful. One. Second point, the most important thing is these figures are coming out from planning. What is planning commission? Please, for the God's sake, don't see. Can I continue?
Yes, yeah, please continue. For once, Rajiv was interrupting you so politely that I didn't think you would get interrupted, but carry on.
See the planning commission, I know 100% it's a part of our political establishment, but somehow, some sort of independent. Vikram, if Rajiv Pratap Rudi is going to interrupt continuously, I'm just walking out.
Yes.
I don't want to speak.
Exactly.
Because I don't want to.
I've not said anything.
Sanjay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. You all are very great.
Sanjay, hang on. Sanjay, hang on. Rajiv is not interrupting you.
You see, the fact
that Senator to come. Rajiv, don't interrupt him. Sanjay, come back.
The poverty line, I think perhaps because politicians are so fond of fasting that they think 32 rupees a day is enough. At least Mr. Sanjay Nirupam had the graciousness to say that I will not accept this poverty line. So I have actually brought a 15 rupee bus ticket and an 18 rupee milk packet. This is 33 rupees. And I offer it to those economists who came up with this poverty line. You know, they're living in this world. So, and Mr. Rudy said that all these people have failed the nation, and I'm an economist, and I'm sorry to say, so have the economists.
So what is your opinion of castration, chemical or otherwise? You remember there was this entire debate as to whether rapists and others should be chemically castrated. And then on The Big Fight, we did have some rather interesting suggestions that were made. Madhu, you tell me a formula that is going to change the way that men look at women in the next 6 months, and I'll say that that's the best solution. It's not going to happen. And we are seeing it
you
not just in India, look abroad. It's got nothing to do with development.
Abraham.
Look what Dominique Strauss-Kahn is accused of doing.
Yeah,
that's a very good example. Let me finish. I'm saying it's the certainty and swiftness of punishment, which may act
as a deterrent. And as I said, the length of the prison sentence.
Not even the length of the certainty and swiftness of it. Our police has such high tolerance for crime that it allows small-time criminals into becoming hardened criminals.
It's a long-term solution.
Certainty and swiftness. You need
it's the same problem as geotagging criminals. By the time we figure this out, we'll all be dead.
Do you think castration is a short-term problem? In which case, as I said, give men a daily dose of lowering the testosterone.
All men, across the board, in the water supply. That's one solution. I guess that's one way, Madhu, of solving the population problem. Castrate all men in India. Done.
Bang. A small daily dose for all men in India in the water supply. But listen, same time I say that performance anxiety in men, including the size of their organ, etc., leads to more brutality.
I don't want to make this facetious, but I have
to say,
after you put drugs into the water supply for all men, they'll have more performance anxiety, I promise.
That's exactly what I'm saying.
I have to pause to this discussion.
This is cynical and absurd. This argument is not acceptable.
The biggest learning years for us are school, right? When we are not learning a certain way, we have to be given a little slightly stricter punishment for the other kids to see that this is going to happen to you if you don't do it, and for the kid himself, that ye hoga if you don't do it right. I'm saying just set an example, put the fear factor, chemical castration has no problems at all. Yes, you could talk about the physical, surgical castration could be a barbaric
castration. That's a bigger deterrent actually. Going by your deterrent argument, you physically castrate 5 or 10 men. There'll be a real serious impact.
Where do you stop?
Rare cases, but in the rarest of rare cases,
the problem is not that, Vikram. It is because we are not able to give punishment to 80,000 cases today in different courts of rape. We are not able to dispense of with justice.
Okay,
Renuka, is that the main problem?
You know, what is actually happening is we are in a transition phase, all right? How women are looked at is what Ranjana's concern is. Yes, we were commodified earlier. Rape was actually considered a way of conquering your enemy. It was a via media to get to the actual goal. We've had war rape, which has finally been taken cognizance of on international communities. But rape, in its own connotation, you have to look at it. The fact of the matter is, you have to bring in the legislation. You have to strengthen your existing legislation. It must act as a severe deterrent. And unless you say, yes, this is a punishable crime, a lot of men commit rape because they know they will get away with it. Because so they're somebody's son, they're related to the local thanedar.
You don't fix your law courts.
Okay.
You don't fix your judicial system, or your Australian laws. Right. It doesn't work like that.
Okay. Justice Sori, part of the problem with...
High righteous moral, no, one minute, your government promised just police reforms, draconian laws and all that. Please try and explain that to the victims of rape, whether it is children, whether it is women, or whether it is men. Please spare me this hypocrisy.
Renuka.
You all talk as if women don't enjoy sex. A lot of women have perfectly consensual good sex, married, unmarried, or otherwise. Kindly, please, don't temper this with hypocrisy. We have to address it for what it is.
You like dramatizing. You're not on stage. This is not theater.
You are the one who came up with castration, drugs and the water supply, and you're saying please dramatize it.
I think if we have chemical castration, if we endorse that and that is legislated, you know, even if there is a one case or two case in the rarest of rare, I think it would send out a very strong message to society. Okay.
7 billion human beings, that's the population of the world in 2011. So we promptly use that occasion to do this interesting big fight on whether population is an asset or a liability, especially here in India. There are times when it is actually good to have an increase in population. Is that what you're arguing?
Well, I think it can become a strategic asset. I think there is safety.
A strategic asset?
Yeah.
Population?
Because, yeah, why
would
not?
You like to expand on that?
Yeah, because there is security and safety.
We invade other countries so we have more population.
Let me explain. Okay, look at the Middle East. You've had this entire Arab Spring, right? Now, population projections, if you look at, they are basically slated to grow in Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. I think the numbers and the sheer young population is working for these countries. They are rejecting Western-backed oppressive monarchies. They want participatory politics. They want to share
Wait a minute. You're
resources.
Saying the Arab Spring is being caused by population explosion?
No, but by a young population. By a young, energetic population, the sheer numbers have
Why
had...
Why do the numbers add up? You could have an energetic, young population, which is not as
numbers,
populous as it is.
Believe me, if they didn't have those sheer numbers, on the strength of numbers, they wouldn't have had today, the people's movements would not have had, Western support.
You could argue that, they are there, and then because there are so many of them, and there's not enough employment, they are angrier, and that's one of the reasons why...
No, I
and
think that's it's a also young population. I mean, over 50-60% of these percent of these populations are slated to be well under 25 or something. And I think numbers can become an asset. And globally, let me also add another dimension here to you. Globally, Muslim communities are growing at about almost 20%, as opposed to an aging Christian Europe American populations. Yeah. So, you know, there is, I think that is going to change world events, world history.
So you're saying, hang on. Now you've got a new thing. Saying that because the population of Muslim countries is going to grow, it's going to be
Muslim communities even in Europe are
will
slated.
Grow.
By 2050, they say half of Europe's populations will be Muslim. I'm very happy. I take great comfort because then at least we won't have
you take comfort
Western...
I'm not sure.
Are we going to
now see...
Because we want our Western powers invading Muslim countries.
Wait a minute. So is this what we're going to see?
No.
She says that the numbers of the Muslim community should grow, especially in Europe, as the numbers of Christian...
It's
coming down. Definitely, I feel sad about the whole thing because the Christian population is coming down and the Muslim community is going up. But
so
then,
therefore, the Christian community should also expand its population.
Definitely, because you know, the Christian community should grow.
Okay. Well,
The whole concept of population need to be based not on religion.
Exactly.
But
hang on, you've got in the religious elements. I'm just trying to establish.
Now, can I say one thing? Holland, the Dutch, they were one of the very tiny states. But the number of people increased in those days, that made them active in their activities, creative and innovative. They have even colonized India from the small little community. Why? Because when there is more people, your requirements are high.
But there were always more Indians than there were Dutch.
I know.
Way more Indians than they have.
That's why. Because their
obviously
systems,
population has nothing to do with it.
They became innovative, creative, which we were not because we had a vast land. They are small places.
They
have
vast population too.
Definitely, but then our...
So if you are saying population makes you more creative, then we had more people even then.
Definitely. Most of Indians are where?
Population.
We are actually transplanting ourselves into other countries because we have better opportunities there.
I must confess, can I just come back to you?
If we really go out there and educate the young people about the consequences of not planning...
But you don't want sex education in India. Both his community and the BJP has opposed sex education in India. We don't allow ourselves to have the opportunity to fix the situation.
Okay.
Yes, we need responsible sexual behavior and we need responsible reproductive health behavior. But they won't allow us to educate the
church. No, that's wrong. You're making a very sweeping statement that the church won't. We are very much for sex education. People should know we are about natural family planning. We are about responsible parent.
Ask the young people if they can deal with natural family planning. Come on, young people.
We will ask them later.
Okay. Now, one more thing I want to say.
Within the boundaries of a family channel, we will certainly.
No, it's like.